reporting on the games you love by people who love to game. The MMO Reporter Network.
You're logging into your favorite game, grinding out some gear. A couple of points added to your stats, and you have a virtual beer. Max level is pretty cool, but I'll remind you here, my friend. These games are not about the goal, it's about the journey and not the end.
You're listening to MMO Reporter, brought to you by Audible.com. Get a free audiobook download at audibletrial.com/MMOReporter. And by Doghouse Systems. Choose your weapon with Doghouse Systems.
Don't forget about your ults. You need to cherish each and every little character you've got, no matter what level they're at. Don't forget about your ults.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of MMO Reporter. This is episode 284. I'm Chris, and I'm joined by the unfortunately under the weather Mr. at MMO Bill. Bill, can you come out of the medicated haze that you're in at the moment to channel your podcasting powers for the night?
I'm surprised you didn't say the ever so under the weather.
Ever so under the weather. Well, I wanted to be kind, Bill. I wanted to be understanding.
I like kind. I need kind. Yeah, I'm going to live. I've determined that doesn't really the bacteria growing, invading my body, they don't get to win. I'm gonna survive. This is gonna be
That's
a
great,
positive
Bill.
Thing.
It's a good thing. I'm really happy for you and your family, and I think this is a really positive step in your recovery. So good job.
Yep. I'm battling the sniffles and I'm gonna win.
Good job. It's not everyone who fights the sniffles quite so bravely as you do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, well,
everybody does. Got to do what you can.
From under that pile of Kleenex, can you see your list of games that you've played this past week?
Yes, and it is very short. I played World of Warcraft this week, believe it or not. My priest is now acceptable in terms of eye level. I've got it up to 843. During our stream on Wednesday, I was being mocked because somebody was claiming that they were a casual player, still outranked my eye level on my priest.
That's true.
And to be fair, it was my second Legion character, so I think it's actually acceptable. Being we ran at 8th. I think I was 838 when we ran on Wednesday, and I'm 843 now, so it's moving along. And
it was catching up to me. You're almost caught up to me.
Yeah, there you go. All I need is that legendary, and I should be right there.
Shut up. I still don't have a legendary.
Yeah. Watch what you wish for. You might get the crappiest one.
I bet. That's probably my luck, too. Yeah.
Anyway, so we did that on Wednesday night. We did all the time-walking dungeons for Wrath of the Lich King.
That was a good night.
It was good. Like, we were a little, I mean, to be fair, we were a little overpowered. We blew through those dungeons in no time, but I really enjoyed the Wrath dungeons. It was a nice trip down memory lane. They were all dungeons that I'd run before way back in Wrath days, and it was good. I liked it. So That was a good night. We also did some world boss raiding, and that was good. And yeah, that was fun. Beyond that, I did a little bit of Guild Wars 2. I finally fed Hungry Hal all the apples.
Oh, good. So I was worried about that all week.
Well, this is the thing. I mean, it sounds like such a silly thing and a silly achievement, but I now have every single Heart of Thorns mastery except for the raid masteries.
Nice.
So I am officially OP in Guild Wars 2.
Good for you.
Yeah, so that was pretty much my week. How about you, Chris? What have you been up to?
Well, we already talked about our WoW time, but I did spend some time as well, probably all of about maybe 13 and a half minutes on my mage, which I'm still, that's what our listeners voted for me to level up, use my boost and get my mage up to level 100. And I did that, and I'm not enjoying the experience in any way whatsoever. I die too much. I've got, yeah. So Anyways, so but on my paladin, I've been diligently doing my dailies, and I did a couple of the LFRs, and I actually tanked through the LFRs. Through a couple of them and getting to know those fights.
Did you know you were the tank?
On purpose, even. Yeah. Look back to past episodes for the story of that. I think I talked about it last week. Yeah, it's fun times doing all that stuff in WoW. I'm really enjoying the regularity of it, and our static group really gives me something to play for. So that's a lot of fun. I also have been continuing on Rift, and I think this may be I have to put it down for a little while. I don't know. I have to go back in and really give it a shot and give it a push. It is such a grind at this point. And I just finished the zone, the second to last big zone, that's the leveling zone. And it was supposed to be a 67, 68 zone, and I'm halfway through 67. The next zone is 68, 69 for levels. And it's a struggle to get through. I can only really take one mob at a time, and I can't do any rifts or invasions without a whole bunch of people. And I understand that's the goal and stuff like that, but there's not enough people around where I am, so everything is a fight. And I don't know if it's the lack of a subscription, which a subscription gives you a bonus to XP. I don't know if they built the leveling curve around having that.
Oh, I wonder.
But it's painful right now. And I'm enjoying what I'm doing, but I'm not enjoying that struggle. So I'm trying to understand if it's... Is it just the grind that I'm disliking or everything? And it's not. It is. I don't dislike the mechanics. I don't dislike the story, the quests. I love all that sort of stuff. I'm really hating the grind.
Mm-hmm. I think that's something that's a really tough thing to balance in MMOs, because nobody wants to feel wimpy in an MMO. You want to feel like that, like a character that could wade into a fight with half a dozen enemies and come out smelling like a rose and that kind of thing. And being defeated one-on-one when you've got nothing else that you can really do isn't fun. So, and maybe that's a symptom of free-to-play, that that you can only have that feeling of power if you play, like, or if you pay. Like, if you've got the subscription, you'll level fast enough that you're never going to feel like you have to grind on mobs that are too difficult for you. So,
yeah. So that's unfortunately, because I'm really enjoying the experience of playing, but it's too tough. And I had the same experience with the last expansion. And Selenia reminded me that Rift has always, we've always been a little bit slower than other games in Rift. It's never been the fastest leveling game. So, I'll have something of a final judgment or critique on it. When I finally decide that I'm not going to move any further in this expansion at this time, I'm still going to plug away at it a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I have jumped back into Lotro, of course, as I always do every week, and continuing to complete the quests around the exterior of the Black Gate. Of course, buoyed by my interview with the Standing Stone Games people, with Cordovan and Severlin, the community manager and the executive producer.
Mm-hmm.
And it's fun. It's just, it's so familiar, which is wonderful. It's so okay to just go around and do stuff on my own. I feel like I'm contributing. I feel like this is Middle Earth, and they really nail it. So that's a really good thing. We'll have a chunk of the show in a little bit where I'll have a little bit of a shortened version of the interview, and we'll have a link in the show notes to the full interview if you want to find out about that. But we'll talk about that in just a little bit. And then, as always, Titanfall 2. Because I do. And all I do is Last Titan Standing. I think I've mentioned this before, but I'll mention it again in case this is someone's first time listening. The Last Titan Standing mode in that shooter, and it's a shooter. It's a fairly fast-paced shooter. I die all the time as a pilot, which is, you know, without your Titan. Your Titan is just a big, ginormous mech, basically, that you're piloting. In Last Titan Standing, everybody's in a mech, so everything's a little slower. And it's just right. And I'm happy.
That's your speed.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm in the high 20s in my generations for my Titan, getting into the 30s, which you kind of level your Titan as you go through as well.
Is it actually leveling your Titan? Like, is your Titan getting more powerful as you go, or is it just
I unlock
that's
cosmetics.
Just how yeah, it's just how old your character is basically. Yeah.
Well, no, you get more experience for winning, for performing well in a match and all that sort of stuff. So it is you level your generations faster for being a better player and for winning more. Mm-hmm. But it does not confer any sort of in-game bonuses other than cosmetics to your Titan or your character levels too.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So it's fun times. I really like it. Although I do wish now that I've gotten to my new computer that I'd gotten it on PC. It's on PS4. My PS4, I need to get a can of compressed air because I swear when it starts going that I'm on the deck of an aircraft carrier and there's a jet about to take off. Because it's going. Its turbines are whirring. So, yeah. But PlayStations have always been like that. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that is our what we have done in game. Want to send a wonderful shout out to our patrons at patreon.com/MMOReporter. They help us keep the lights on. If you want to become a patron, go check it out. And if you want to support the network in other ways, we'll have a link in the show notes and we'll mention it at the end. I'm just realizing as we go on to the moves, we forgot this week to ask our chat room what they've been doing. We'll get back to that again next week because now it's time to move on to the news.
If you only knew how easy it can be to fool the boss from me more than deeps is all you have to do to make the raid, then you would.
All right, so we have got some news from Marvel Heroes, which fits right into that Neverwinter and other games that we wish we had more time for. Marvel Heroes has come out with their biggest update ever. And this is an update that's going to be coming up that's going to have tons of new stuff, like a ton of stuff that's going on, right from changes to the heroes, some events, a difficulty slider, some story mode updates, all that sort of stuff, and some changes to the Omega system. They're removing it and introducing an Infinity system, as in the Infinity Stones. So we'll have a link to that. But the one big thing that we wanted to focus on here was the talents and traits, the way in which they're changing those. There's not going to be any more power points. So the way that you leveled in the game is you played and you got XP, you picked up the little green orbs and they gave you XP, and you would then get points when you leveled, and you would assign those points into one of three talent trees. They're not going to have any more power points. You're not going to be putting points into a power. And the way it worked before is you'd have one power and you'd put one point and you'd unlock it, and then it would be a weak version of that power. You'd put more points into it and it would strengthen that power. Now you're just going to unlock the power and it will be at its full strength for your level. They'll scale it based on your character level. And so you won't have to worry about respecking to try out a power at full strength, because you get more powers in Marvel Heroes than you have room on your bar. So you have to pick which ones you're going to put on your bar. And so in the past, when you wanted to try out a new power to see if it deserved that space, you had to totally respec to put all the points into it to see what it was like at full power. And you won't have to do that anymore. So that's pretty interesting. And then the second one is they're removing specializations. And specializations were ways to alter powers to give you a more distinctive play style. So now each hero will have 5 sets of talents. Talents will unlock as you level your hero, offering choices over time as you learn the nuances of your ability. They can range from passive bonuses to mechanic changes to completely removing a power from your power tree and replacing it with a new one. These talents occupy a hero's third power trees, with all active skills being migrated into the first two trees. So basically, instead of having the three specs that you had before that you could build up, you're going to have two, and then you're going to have the talents occupying the third one to modify those two. Pretty big changes to the way in which characters are grow, I guess, mm-hmm. is the best word, throughout the game. What do you think about this way of doing it, Bill?
Well, my gut is, and I have to couch this, I think in order to really appreciate these settings, you have to have a pretty good understanding of Marvel Heroes, and mine is basic, but it seems like it's a big simplification, as far as I can tell, that basically your powers are your powers and you set up your hero the way you want as you unlock those powers. You don't have weird little paths or conditions or points or currency or any kind of anything like that to worry about. You just build what you want.
Right.
Right? Am I misunderstanding that?
Pretty much.
Oh.
Yeah.
No, am I misunderstanding I understanding?
You're understanding it. Yeah, you're getting it
pretty much. Okay, there we go. Yeah. Bill, you screwed it right up. So, I mean, that's such a big thing. I mean, when you're talking about a free-to-play game that relies on, I think, more on tourist players than it does on the people that are there every single night grinding through everything, having that kind of flexibility where you can kind of just step in and do what you want is important. Like, you talk about investment in games and really working through and earning things, it's still ultimately a game. And especially when it's a little bit more of a casual game, which I consider Marvel Heroes to be. Like, Marvel Heroes does seem to, its popularity wanes and grows. You can almost time it perfectly by when the movies are coming out and when there's a new Marvel movie coming out. All of a sudden, Marvel Heroes seems to spike up a little bit in,
or Netflix shows. That is a direct correlation between my playtime.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think when you're relying on those kind of tourist type players, this is a good change. So well done. Yeah, it's a good understanding of who your players are. And I think that's a really positive thing. There's a lot of games out there that don't really seem to have a very good picture of who their player base are and what they want. And they're trying to make a game and they're trying to make the best game they can, but they're not making the best game they can for the players that they have. They're making it because there's some mystical pile of players out there that they just don't quite have yet. And it's a very obvious disconnect between the community and the game maker when that happens, but I don't think that's happening in this case. Obviously, somebody gets what Marvel Heroes actually is.
Yeah. This is a very, very big update, and there's a lot coming through here.
So it's the biggest update ever, don't you know?
It really is. It really is. So we'll have a link to the forum post that goes over all of these things. Neither of us are big enough Marvel Heroes players to understand this completely, but there's a lot of information here. Love to hear what all of you think what you think about this update. If you are a Marvel Heroes player, a regular player, and you've gone through all of this information and you've parsed it, we'd love to hear what you think and if you're excited about this or what you might be unhappy about as they move forward with these changes. All right, Bill, you have got some information about a little infighting in the World of Warcraft private server community.
And, I mean, I'm starting to get a little bit weary of this whole thing, but Nostalrius is back in the news again. So just to give everybody a quick recap what Nostalrius is and what the history here is. Nostalrius.
Sorry, hold on. Wait. Last time on the Nostalrius drama. Okay, go ahead.
So it started off with Nostalrius was this fan-run set of servers that ran vanilla World of Warcraft and was trying to recreate that experience. Blizzard got fed up with it and said, nuh-uh, not allowed to do that anymore. Nostalrius has then, since then, really gone on a bit of a crusade, saying, okay, we weren't trying to run these servers for profit. We weren't trying to be evil about this, or at least really evil anyway. We just wanted to recreate that vanilla experience. We think that's important. Blizzard has kind of said that, yes, we hear what you said. We maybe even understand it a little bit. We have no plans at this time to do that, but we won't eliminate the possibility completely. Nostalrius carries on. They shut down their servers, but they carry on kind of waving the flag of give us back our vanilla, give us back our vanilla. To the point, and they felt that they were just ignored too long by Blizzard, so they gave all their code and data and all the systems that they used to run Nostalrius over to a group called Elysium. Elysium is based out of the Ukraine, which is a lot harder for Blizzard to shut down than Nostalrius was, which I believe was operated out of the United States. And it was back. They ported over the character data that was there. Apparently, only a tiny amount of Nostalrius players actually merged or migrated over to the Elysium servers, though, in order to continue playing. So that's kind of happened. And then all of a sudden today, we finally got to the news from today. Sorry for the run-up there, people. Nostalrius has said, yeah, we don't like this arrangement anymore. Elysium, can you please stop using our code and we'll just pretend this never happened. To which Elysium said, fine, you big babies. Take your stupid code back. So this is such a weird thing to me, because Nostalrius really seems to be beating the drum that they've got the moral high ground, but that they're trying to create a fan experience, not a pirated experience. They're not trying to give you free World of Warcraft. They're just trying to give you the World of Warcraft that they played and loved. And I could sort of understand it, but at the same time, running a pirate server for World of Warcraft is not going to win you the moral high ground battle. Like, Blizzard is not the bad guy here. Unfortunately, I mean, they might be withholding something that a lot of people want, but Blizzard is not the bad guy. They are often the bad guy in many different disagreements. Don't get me wrong. Blizzard is not a set of angels, but in this case, they're not wrong. So
yeah. So
now go ahead.
Hey, yeah, go ahead. No, go ahead.
I was going to say, what Nostalrius, I think, really needs to do is, if they actually think this message of Vanilla WoW is an important message, they've got to go through some good channels for a while. They made their statement. They made the news big time. We've talked about them many times, and I'm not saying that we're the ones that make the news, but many people have talked about Nostalrius many, many times. They are known in the gaming world. They need to translate that notoriety into some positive dialogue, and so they need to find a way to keep haranguing Blizzard, but do it in a positive way. I mean, it's almost like political protest. That, I mean, there's a line you cross that you could send a good message, you can have your moral high ground, but you know, as soon as you have a riot, your message is lost. And I think they've felt that setting their servers back up on Elysium was kind of like them having their political riot.
Well, two things. First of all, isn't it Blizzard's code to begin with?
Yes, so it's not Nostalrius. Well, there's things that Nostalrius made that Blizzard didn't, that made Nostalrius. But yes, the game is still Blizzard's.
And second thing, someone's pining to be the Blizzard legacy server team. Come on, we can do this. It's nice. It's pretty. It's we'll play nice. We'll be friendly. We won't cause any waves. Please hire us. We'll work for you. We'll be nice.
Well, and that might be it too. You could, there's the cynic would say that this is the long con, that they're just trying to get jobs. Yeah. But if you really believe in the message, then sure, it's not a bad message, but you have to, at this point, they really have to work hard to stay on brand and stay positive and not get dragged down into the muck.
Yeah.
And the Nostalrius people, that is, not Blizzard or Elysium.
I will be told I'm wrong. I will be yelled at, argued with, whatever, by the community at large. I am sure that I would probably say over 90% of the people who played on Astarius and Elysium are playing because they can get free WoW. The vanilla and legacy portion of it, I think, is a small part of it.
Well, Nostalrius wasn't free, as I recall. Like, they had a nominal fee to keep, and I believe that the money that they made was actually for the infrastructure to run the server. I think there's a lot of people in that
premium thing, though, like not a requirement thing.
I don't know. Anyway, but I think the important thing is in that scene, the Nostalrius people wouldn't want to be equated with Elysium. Like, I think there is a bit of a snobbishness there that Nostalrius people are WoW fans and Elysium players are WoW pirates.
It's funny, too. I was looking at different streams, and on Twitch, there were maybe three or four quite low on the sort of list of streamers for World of Warcraft, whereas on YouTube, I think out of the top 10, six or seven of them were Elysium people streaming from there. So it's interesting that that community split that way as well. A lot more established people on established WoW going through Twitch, whereas YouTube gaming is still not as established as Twitch is for streaming. So. Anyways, that's my thoughts about that. Any final thoughts about this this horrible, horrible, bitter feud between these two rivals?
Yeah, not really. I think what I want to see more than anything else is just positive messaging from Nostalrius and really trying to push that agenda in a positive way rather than negative, because I kind of like the principle. I like the notion of a vanilla WoW server, because I think WoW is one of those games that's important enough to the MMO landscape that having the reference of that vanilla experience is probably valuable, like just to the culture. So having would be good.
Yeah, EQ had progression servers for a long time, right? They they rolled back and started and rolled out expansions as they went through.
I thought they still did.
I do believe they still do, but I tend to refer to everything about EverQuest in the past tense because it is, what, like 15 million years old?
Yeah, at least.
Okay, so let's quickly talk about our sponsors. Audible, go to audiblepodcast.com/MMOReporter, and you can get a free month of their subscription service, which will get you a free book. Once you've spent your credit, you can cancel whenever you'd like, and you get to keep the book forever. So they are the best providers of audiobooks, so go check them out. Plus, if you use audiblepodcast.com/MMOReporter, it helps keep the lights on here at MMO Reporter. And our friends over at Doghouse, go to doghousesystems.com, use the coupon code MMOReporter, and you will get an SSD with your purchase added to whatever you're already getting. So it's a really, really great deal. And again, it helps us keep the network going. And we've got a few upgrades that we need to do to what we're doing with the different shows. So anything that you can do to help would be appreciated. So just go to doghousesystems.com. And use the coupon code MMOReporter. Right now, we're going to move on to the next segment of the news.
When your healer yells out of mana, pull that world boss out of party. Run through trash, you'll be sorry. Take a bio break without announcing. They may not rhyme, but they're quite possibly the dumbest ways to die. Dumbest ways to die.
All right, so we're going to have a little bit of a pre-recorded segment here. As I mentioned before, I did talk to the folks over at Standing Stone Games about their split from Turbine and taking Lotro and DDO into this new gaming entity and running it with the publishing support from Daybreak Games. So let's take a listen to a little bit of parts of it right now. I am chatting with Jerry Snook, aka Cordovan, from Standing Stone Games. Hello, Jerry.
Hey, Chris, how's it going? Appreciate you being here.
It's wonderful to talk to you again. And we also have Rob Ciccolini. He is known as Severlin. Hello, Rob. How are you doing?
I'm doing great.
How is this working as far as who owns Standing Stone Games?
Sure. Let me preface sort of our talk on Standing Stone Games with a little bit of a disclaimer, and that is that there are certain things we're not able to talk about. You know, this was a private business deal. And so there are some certain aspects that I know people might be interested in that we're not going to be able to answer. And so I do apologize about that.
Right.
But we are the developer now for DDO and Lotro as an independent group called Standing Stone Games. And we are getting publishing support. Our publisher is Daybreak.
Okay. So I'm asking, it'd be a cool kind of a... So is it owned by the employees? Are you able to get into that a little bit? Or is it sort of an external source?
I don't know how much I can get into that, okay. Although I could say that it is not owned by employees. We're not sort of some kind of co-op
right.
sort of studio here. It is a traditionally funded development studio.
Right. Yeah. So how did this come about? Like, what was the journey from going to, integrated parts of Turbine into your own company now, understanding that about, 6 months ago, maybe a little bit more, Turbine announced that they were making a move towards being a mobile development studio?
Turbine has been great to work for, but they definitely wanted to take a change in direction with Warner Brothers. And I totally get that. When that came up, there's been a long discussion about, how can we best serve the players of the MMOs. Nobody wanted them to suffer because of the change in direction in Warner Brothers. And Warner Brothers was absolutely fantastic about helping us and helping us with Daybreak to turn this around and keep the games going and still allow Warner Brothers to concentrate on the new direction that they wanted to.
Right. Was there ever discussion of, Turbine wants to go to be a mobile game studio, and I guess we're going to have to look at whether we sort of sunset the MMO portion of the studio?
I don't think that anybody wanted to do that because there are too many loyal fans. Turbine is not like some corporate entity. It's full of gamers like you and me. And so they're pretty sensitive and empathic to the love of the MMOs, and they themselves love these games because a lot of them worked on them.
Is it weird now talking about Turbine as an external entity rather than we?
Sure, absolutely.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
How did it happen? Like, there was some internal discussion. Was there a lot of ramp up, or did you guys have to move pretty quickly to make this happen? How did that process work out?
Yeah, it was a weekend. It took about a weekend, right?
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
I can neither confirm nor deny the long and arduous process of splitting this out. No matter how long you think it takes, like, it takes longer.
And what do you think was the most challenging part of excising yourself from Turbine?
There was just so many moving pieces there's so many things that are tied up into the company that people don't even think about, like who owns all the licenses for the software and how do we move the hardware and, what do we do about the shared bits? Because there was a lot of things that we did to leverage WB and their power in our sort of technology that had to be kind of moved away and split, and that was just a tremendous effort from our tech ops and our technical team.
Yeah, it's a little different from, let's just say, if for some reason a studio was transferring an IP from one developer to another, because in this case we have two long-standing games that have large active communities and a fairly large and robust infrastructure to support it. As the business needs of everyone was kind of in transition here, we had to get all the lawyers together. We had to get all the tech people together. Various parts of the studio had to say, okay, now what about this piece? Okay, then we got that one figured out. Oh, but what about this, and this, right? And so it tended to just be a little bit of a game of whack-a-mole for not insignificant period of time until everyone was on the same page, all the issues had been worked out, everyone was ready to go, and we were able to have all the lawyers and all that sort of thing do all their final paperwork and all that to get it going. But it was really just a I mean, I don't want to say too slow a process, but it was a process that really just involved working through just a massive pile of details to sort through.
And what about, excuse me, the development teams themselves? Was there some discussion there of, do you want to move to this new company? Do you want to stay with Turbine? Did any developers choose to stay with Turbine?
I think that problem had sorted itself out much earlier. Mm-hmm. Because Turbine basically was doing mobile games, there's been a long process of like, hey, who wants to work on the mobile games? Who wants to work on the, you know, on the PC games? What do you want to do? So by the time this process even began, which was quite a while ago, people had already sort of gravitated towards where they wanted. And of course, that was asked. But for the most part, by the time this was in full swing, everybody had already were already on the projects that they wanted to be on.
Mm-hmm. And to formally answer your question, I can't think of anybody who was on one of the MMO teams that was actively employed on that team. And then when we transitioned, moved back to a different thing. So.
Right. And I know this is a question that was asked a few times in our chat rooms. Where are you physically working? Or did you have a big moving day and the U-Hauls were out and you moved all the hardware?
No,
or?
Not really. So, Turbine rents a large office space in the Boston area here. And so there was plenty of room to fit really a second studio in there. By the time everything had been signed, one of the advantages of the length of time is it gave us an opportunity to prepare for some of that stuff, not just on the technical side, but on the human resources side as well. Mm-hmm. So essentially what was a very large office with some unused space ended up getting really turned into two separate offices. And so for a lot of us, it was really just a matter of sitting down at the same desk we were sitting at a couple of months ago. It's just under a new scenario with a few new walls and locks and that sort of thing, because they had to do a little bit of building work there. But at least for a little while here, we're really sharing our former studio space.
Oh, that's pretty convenient too, and that must allow you as well to keep the momentum going as far as the development of the games goes, because while all this other stuff may have been going on, you don't have a programmer is not worrying about the legalities of who owns the toilet paper in the washroom, right? So that must have been nice for the teams to be able to keep working and stay in the same space during that time.
The answer is the teepee is owned by our landlord. No, but yeah, I mean, it was nice, and for it was fairly smooth for a lot of the DDO and Lotro devs, because they were able to continue to sort of the process that they were able to do. I don't want to say that part of this was motivated by a lot of pen and paper gaming that happens in the office, but at least short term here, we have not disrupted too many campaigns.
Well, that's good to hear. I wouldn't want someone's campaign interrupted. One of the questions that came out of our chat room as well when we were discussing this was a little bit about the nebulous nature of what publishing deals are and the different interpretations that different people had about that. So can you clear it up a little bit for us as far in generalities, of course, not into the minutiae of it, but what is Daybreak's role in what Standing Stone Games is producing?
Well, I think it's difficult to answer because this is such a unique situation. I mean, I don't think it's ever been done other than EverQuest. So we have two sides. One is both us and Daybreak really want to give the studio as much independence as possible, because the games are beloved. They don't want to mess with that. On the other hand, in order to save sort of money, we want to leverage as much Daybreak technology as possible when we're going forward, because they also have a lot of knowledge. So even though we remain an independent studio, we'll probably leverage some of their technology in terms of, you might see something like the launcher changes to use more Daybreak technology as a money-saving thing. But we're not planning on having like a grand unified account that, you know, that you would do, or like the LOTRO points and DDO points will stay LOTRO points and DDO points. And Daybreak isn't planning on coming in and sort of overseeing how we've been doing things. We want to do those things that the players love as much as possible. So I think that it's a simple relationship in that we're independent. Daybreak gives us a lot of technology that we can eventually move to, and I think that that is going to benefit our studio a lot.
Yeah, if you think about the scale of something like an MMO, I mean, there's a lot of infrastructure that really is needed to support that, and that infrastructure is able to realize some significant cost savings by through say Daybreak, because they're already operating other online games and things like that. You know, everything from say even some minor stuff like billing and human resources and you know, domain registrations and things like that, that just, it's easier to have a larger group that is already in the process of overseeing that for large games sort of lend their expertise to the process rather than having to hire people and do that as the size of the development studio that we are. You know, traditionally, to answer the what is a developer, what is a publisher, back in, let's just say, the old days of the 90s when things were printed on plastic, you know, the idea was that the developer would make the game, they would give it to the publisher would do the disc printing, you know, a lot of the marketing, things like that, and then, you know, would be, in many ways, the public face of that game. Obviously, that doesn't apply in our digital world here, but a lot of that sort of relationship is the same. You know, we do the development of the game, and the publishing arm is done by Daybreak.
Right. I know that was with some publisher and developer relationships, there is some editorial control, but that doesn't sound like that's the case in this situation.
I mean, we'll see what ends up happening here, but, you know, both games have long-standing communities with long-standing development teams with a lot of institutional knowledge. You know, we know how to make these games, and we know how to keep them successful. So to some extent, it's like, don't rock the boat.
Right. And there's no, I think Rob mentioned that, there's no move towards the being part of the Daybreak sort of subscription service that they have where you can get access to all the games, or a move to Daybreak Cash or anything like that.
I haven't heard of any of that kind of stuff happening.
Okay. No, we don't have plans. I mean, unless the reason we don't want to say absolutely is because there may be a big press from the players that would, you know, in a year or two, if the players are like, hey, why can't I do this?
Right.
I don't know. We've always tried to sort of get player preferences and feedback into our plans. So so sometimes, you know, If there's a great demand, I'm not saying it could never happen. We just don't have any plans for it in the foreseeable future.
Yeah, and it, like Jerry said, in this digital age, anything you say can be held against you at a future date. So,
that's never happened.
Yeah, oh, I mean, we're pretty good about sort of saying unwise things and just relying on the good natures of the PCs to know that, like, hey, things can change.
Right.
So if we talk and say too much and then we have to change our plans, sometimes our plans change.
Now, when this was starting out, was there ever any thought of perhaps bringing Asheron's Call along with LOTRO and DDO into Standing Stone Games, or was that never part of the equation?
I hate to be the PR guy, but I can't really talk about anything related to Asheron's Call there. Sorry.
Okay, that's okay. It's just a great deal of sad. That was the first MMO that I ever dove into and connected with. So it's really interesting to see what they're doing here, how a lot of work went into making this transition work. And if you want to hear more and the full interview, which includes some future update news for DDO and for LOTRO, we'll have a link in the show notes to the full interview. Bill, I know Final Fantasy is a game that we have talked about many, many times that we really need to get you into. It's It's really far, though, on the edge of what we have time to do. Do you like what I did there? Do you like that? You like, yeah. So we are going to talk. That was painful. I know. It was. I'm sorry. That's really what it comes down to. We are going to talk about Final Fantasy XIV patch 3.5, The Far Edge of Fate. There is a trailer and some patch notes as well. I'm going to play the trailer because it is officially the world's longest trailer for a game. It is actually 8.5 minutes long. It's not so much as a trailer as a compilation of content that will be coming with this patch. It doesn't have a narrative to the trailer per se. I will say this, holy crap, Final Fantasy XIV looks great.
Mm-hmm.
Saying that. So this is the first step on the way to the new expansion, which will be coming out later this year. And they're going to have some new dungeon content. They're going to have some new main scenario quests, which is the main story, and some beast tribe quests, as well as a ton of other stuff. The one thing that I saw, and there wasn't a lot of discussion online about this, but the one thing I noticed that was really interesting over at Massively OP, and we'll have a link to this in the show notes, I think two or three of the six or seven comments for the article were saying, man, just when I was about to end my sub to the game, they come out with content, and it's not the first time. So Final Fantasy XIV has that cadence down right, because just when people seem to be getting tired, they put out new content.
You could almost consider that a little bit evil, but evil, yeah. or competent, you decide.
It was funny because they were talking about, there were two sort of different narratives. One was, oh, now I got a sub again. And the other one is, I'm just going to go to YouTube and watch all the cinematics to get the story. Mm-hmm. So yeah, and the cinematics, it is like a lot of Final Fantasy, it is very, very pretty. It's a pretty game, Bill. I like pretty, yep, games.
Yeah, I want to play. It's on my list, and when my new computer arrives, then it is going to be a game I play.
Yeah, and there
not is... that my computer is on its way, its concept is on the way.
It is. There's a page, too, with all the information here where you can look up what's going to be coming with the main scenario, the side story quests, the new dungeons, containment bay Z1T9, anima weapons. They're making some changes. You looked it up. What was the changes to housing again, Bill?
So the housing changes were them basically adding the ability to put up portraits and aquariums, it seems. There's probably more, but that's all I've found so far.
Okay, well, there is...
For all the housing addicts out there.
Yeah, there's lots of details on this page as well. We'll have a link to a little bit more patch note-y document as well if you want to go in and find out all the details about all the changes that they're making. So you can go check that out there. Again, every time I watch a Final Fantasy XIV thing, I'm like, I got to get back in there. And then I remember trying to sign up for a subscription, and I'm like, oh, right. Yeah, it's a pain. Okay. Any final thoughts here before we move on? Because I think the next story is quite meaty.
I was just going to say, do you whisper about that every time? Is it a secret that it's a pain?
No, I whisper when I resub to WoW.
No.
That's my whisper.
All right.
Yeah, by the way, the chat room's talking about the pre-alpha build for your computer.
Ah, I like that. I like that idea. Anyway, speaking of ideas, I don't know if this was the best idea, but the repopulation is going through another bit of drama. It feels like we got a dramatic episode here today. Anyway, so again, this is something that needs a little bit of history. So the repopulation was originally going to be developed by a team called Above and Beyond. And it was, mm-hmm. And I think when people actually started to get to play the preview version of it, that was what was made by Above and Beyond. Then something happened, and Idea Fabric, which is the company that makes the engine that the repopulation runs on, basically pulled the rights from the engine, and the repopulation kind of fell off the edge of the earth. And then a bunch of negotiation and weird things happened and everything like that. And finally, it came back now that Above and Beyond is out making their own game. I believe that game is called Fragmented. And which is, from what I've read and heard, very, very similar to what the repopulation is, but we won't go there now. Idea Fabric, which is the company that makes the engine, is now also in charge of developing the repopulation. But they've contracted, or they've got some kind of agreement with Above and Beyond to help transition what they did with the repopulation to Idea Fabric. So ultimately, the end thing, or the end event, is going to be Idea Fabric will own and run the repopulation. Above and Beyond will help them get there and then separate and become their own and own development studio, making Fragmented and whatever else they're going to make.
Right.
So that's where we are today now.
The repopulation does have a fairly vocal community. It went through two Kickstarters and a few rounds of crowdfunding on its own website as well. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it has a fairly vocal community. The one thing, and I'll say this, I've tried it a few times at PAX, so that's the only time I've ever played it, and I never really connected with it. I think that first, it's in a lot of ways a spiritual successor to Star Wars Galaxies. That was a lot of the inspiration. But the mechanics of the game, whenever I played it, you know, it can look old, but when it feels old at the same time, that takes away a lot of the fun for me. And it just always felt clunky. So it was really hard for me to really get a lot of enjoyment out of it. And I don't know if that was troubles that they had with the engine, which was the Hero Engine. And now it's the developer of the Hero Engine who's making it. So I don't know what that's going to mean. But I do think the repopulation community has always been very, very strong. So I hope that they aren't the ones who bear the brunt of any changes that happens here. I still hope that all those crowdfunders get the game that they hoped they would get when they spent their money.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. But this, and I hate to undercut people that might be good and deserve it and everything like that, but please just stop pre-ordering games. You know, wait until it's done. Buy it then. Support game developers. Buy the games you want to play. Don't pirate and all that kind of thing. But just wait until the game's out. Because
bonuses, Bill. What if they have a mount?
I have no words. I'm too sick to refute your spider mount.
And the spider mount was real money transaction. It wasn't a...
Yeah. So, anyway. We'll see. We'll see how this shakes out. It would be nice if the repopulation turned into a decent game. I hope Above and Beyond have success with Fragmented, and I hope that nobody pre-orders anything ever again.
I can't disagree with you. I would love to hear from the repopulation community, though, about your thoughts on this transition. What you have been told as backers of the Kickstarter, have you gotten emails from Idea Fabric or from A&B saying, hey, this is what's going to happen? So I would love to hear from all of you if you have any news about this. All right, time to move on to our quick mentions for this week. Bill, you are the Guild Wars 2 player. Guild Wars 2 Lunar New Year. Are you excited?
I'm aware and I don't hate it. Lunar New Year has launched.
Wow, don't get too excited.
Oh, I know, but this is kind of the Guild Wars 2 equivalent of Chinese New Year. The event this year is pretty light. They have a brawl type event called the Dragon Ball Arena, which has some special rewards and that associated to it, and another achievement, and not much else, some cash shop stuff in the, or gem store stuff, if you want to call it that, is there with this event as well. But it's hard. I don't usually get too excited about that. They have some interesting dyes, actually, some of the colors that they put out with this event are pretty cool. Yeah. But nothing. If you like Guild Wars 2, then sample the Lunar New Year event, and then keep waiting for the next chapter.
Yep. Okay, Asheron's Call, since we are all feeling incredibly sad about its loss, there is a great playlist on YouTube where a player, I'm going to say Zepesh, takes us through a tour of all the towns in Asheron's Call. Now, Bill, what is the name of the... Arwick is the name of the town that was where the meteor came, which we've talked about a million times. My favorite end of beta event ever, right? Why don't you talk a little bit about that?
Lovingly called Charwick because it was reduced to char. So I mean, this is just for all the people out there that played Asheron's Call out there. I like this playlist. I'm gonna subscribe to it and favorite it and everything like that, or like it. I mean, it's a nice nostalgic trip. I mean, obviously we're not gonna have Asheron's Call to jump into anymore, and really who was actually planning to jump back in. But just reviewing the videos and enjoying it, there was a lot to like about Asheron's Call. There's lots of good vibes. I remember enjoying it so much. It's not the prettiest game. It's aged, and it looks aged, and it's earned its age. Like, you know how some people, when you get old, there comes to a point where you can't be ashamed of being old. You've earned it, so enjoy it. And that's really what I think Asheron's Call is. That said, I enjoy their UI so much. Like the font is a little bit jaggy in that, but it's a tidy UI. It doesn't overwhelm the screen. The game is the biggest part of it. It's not the action buttons or menus or anything like that. So if you're looking for that little bit of nostalgia, then it's worthwhile. But yeah, check the Arwick video. He takes a visit to the smoking pit that has been a smoking pit since the game was released in 1999, which is pretty spectacular, if I do say so myself. And
the start of grind, like it's 1999.
It was back in the day. All you had was the grind. So you had to enjoy the grind. We walked uphill both ways, and we leveled uphill both ways.
In the grind, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, second to last one here. Homesteads is launching, which is the housing update for ESO, is launching February 6th on PC and February 21st on consoles. This is, if you want to hear what our thoughts about it or our description of it, it's a couple weeks back, but it is coming out. It's going to be a free update, and it's going to introduce 39 uniquely themed homes that you can acquire throughout Tamriel, and includes over 2,000 individual decorative and furniture options, plus furniture crafting. So if you're in ESO, you're interested in housing, this is it for you. And I like that it has a... different tiers of housing. So for me, who's not really into it, I would get like a room at an inn, and that would be my housing. Somebody who's really into it would get like a spacious mansion. And I think that's really, really cool. I approve. And for those of you who are Path of Exiles players, I know that we've covered the game a few times here on the show. You might be excited about this news that Path of Exiles is launching on Xbox One at some point in 2017. No more details than that. I'm interested for this. I have played a little bit of Path of Exile. As Bill has said, it's very, very similar to Diablo, the sort of dungeon runner sort of thing, but much more complicated. The person who usually helps me out with all of our Path of Exile coverage is very curious about this Xbox announcement, Sammy, because he's wondering about some of the systems, some of the mechanics that he has a hard time imagining on Xbox One because they're so complex. And I think that's always the big... the big question mark whenever you have a game porting over to consoles is some of the more especially an MMO, which often has a very complex system, trading, crafting, whatever. It's not always easy to do on a console without a keyboard and mouse. So it's interesting. Are you more interested now? I know you don't have an Xbox One, but is this going to make you get an Xbox One?
No. No, if I want to play Path of Exile, I'd play it on my PC. I enjoyed Path of Exile. Like, it was actually, I think it's a decent game. I hope it does well.
Great. Okay, so now for our last segment here, what are we playing next week? Chat room, why don't you let us know, because I remember this time, what you'll be playing in the chat room. Bill, what are you going to be doing?
I'm going to take a run at Project Gorgon. We've been talking about that for, I think it's been a couple of weeks now, but I'd like to try that out. We've been talking about DDO a little bit. I might actually take a run at that. I've got the installer ready to go and everything on my system. So yeah, we'll give it a try. And then probably keep on with WoW. Do another Wednesday night run next week, try to grind up a few more gear points, just keep on going with that. That's been fun.
Cool. You're going to help me level my mage, right?
Oh, right. That's the other thing I'm going to do, yeah.
I'll be in WoW. I'll be playing Project Gorgon. I'll be doing DDO. That sounds very familiar. But I'll also be playing Rift a little bit more. Like I said, I'm going to plug away a little bit more at it. And I hope that I get past this. Maybe it's just this part of the expansion. And by that, I mean everything I've done so far. And then I've just got to get past this chunk and then it'll be fun. I don't know. It's really, I got to say it again. It's hard for me to split my dislike of the grind with my enjoyment of everything else about the game. Mm-hmm. Right? So anyways, and Titanfall 2, because who doesn't play Titanfall 2 every week? Right? I do.
Yes.
Yep. And Gump's Gang in the chat room has let us know that he'll be playing DDO, two more levels to 30. Good job. About 2 million XP. Final Fantasy 14 and Diablo 3.
Huh? Cool.
That's another one I need to get back into. Maybe I'll do some couch co-op with my kids because we've got it on PS4 as well. Oh, that'd be a fun game to do some couch co-op on. Mm-hmm. Okay, so Bill, if people want to get a hold of us, how can they do that?
Well, they can visit us over at mmoreporter.com. They can send us an email at mmo.reporter@gmail.com. You can visit us at Facebook, facebook.com/mmoreporter. You can tweet at either of us, either at @mmo_reporter for Chris or at @mmobill for yours truly. You can give us a call at 616-666-6778. You can check out our YouTube channel, youtube.com/mmoreporternetwork. The network is an important piece of that.
It is.
You can visit us over at Patreon, patreon.com/mmoreporter, if you'd like to make a donation and help us keep rolling with the shows and the streams and the good times and the colds and the new PCs for Bill. And oh, wait, that's something else. Anyway, otherwise, if you're not a Patreon person, check out mmoreporter.com/support for other ways you can help out.
Awesome. Well, Bill, it was a pleasure as always. I had a lot of fun.
Yeah, thank you. Like, me too.
In our wonderful chat room, who came out and hung out with us, as always, it was a lot of fun to have you here. So thank you ever so much. Thanks to all of you at home who listen to the podcast, watch the podcast on YouTube, however you may consume it. We sure appreciate it. We hope you come back again next week. But of course, most importantly, we hope to see you in game.
Don't forget about your ults you need to cherish. Each and every little character you've got.
Thanks for watching the video, everybody. Don't forget to check out all the other podcasts at mmoreporter.com or by clicking on any of the links here. And please check out our Patreon campaign at patreon.com/mmoreporter. Thanks, everyone, and see you in game.